People of God, good morning and welcome to worship today. We are in the season of Pentecost where we focus on our growth in discipleship. And for us, as people in a rather white denomination, part of that discipleship on the heels of Juneteenth is learning how we can grow in being better supports and how we can grow as a society in justice, mercy, and love. So during our service, we will begin with words of confession, admitting our complicit nature of in the injustice in our world. We will also have a time for prayers. And during that time, you are invited to type your prayers into the comments on Facebook, and we will pray them even as the prayer leader is speaking and singing prayers. And now we invite you to join in worship. You can follow along in our worship bulletin, which is found on our website. And we begin with a confession and forgiveness. We're gathered in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Hear the good news. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. May Almighty God strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. And now the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. Let us pray. Teach us, good Lord God, to serve you as you desire, to give and not to count the cost, to fight and not to heed the wounds, to toil and not to seek for rest, to labor and not to ask for reward, except that of knowing that we do your will, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. And now we join in our children's time, led with Pastor Patty.
Good morning. It's so nice to be with you again during this children's time. And I'm imagining all of you sitting around here with me, even though you're all watching from home. And I just want you to know that I feel your presence here, and I'm glad to be spending this time with you. And I have a question, which was sent out to families by Kim. Kim Weber sent out a question to all of you about what your hobbies are or what your favorite hobby is. And a hobby, as you know, is something that doesn't fall under the category of chores and it doesn't fall under the category of schoolwork. It's something that you enjoy doing, that one enjoys doing in their free time. So I received some beautiful photographs from many of you showing your favorite hobby. And I'm going to share those with you right now. Lucy Weber's favorite hobby is shopping. She loves to go shopping, and you can see from this photograph that she has collected quite an array of beautiful shopping bags. Lucy Fabro notes that in the dog days of summer, which are absolutely coming up. We've had a little bit of taste of them. Lucy enjoys spending time with her new puppy, Tana. Oh, cute, cute, cute. And then we have Jonah and Logan Schreiber. And here's a picture of an amazing fort that they built inside using all of their family's blankets and chairs, I imagine. And they like to create those forts and play in those forts. And they also love to play with their Legos. Those are both great hobbies. And then there's Henry Nelson, who loves his dog Ruby. There's another dog lover. And he says, Ruby is very sweet and very comforting. And Ruby does indeed look incredibly comforting to me. And then there's Isaac, his brother Nelson, who he loves everything about cars. And his hobby is being around as many cars as he can be around, particularly his favorite car, which is his dad's Dodge. He loves his father's Dodge, and that's his favorite. And you've got a picture here of it right there. Now, if some of you weren't able to send in a photograph, please go ahead and you might write next to this recording on your Facebook page what your hobbies are or what your favorite hobby is. And I'm going to share with you, it's not really a hobby because I'm not that good at it, but one of the things that I do love to do, and you can see what I have here, are binoculars. I love bring my binoculars out and try to find birds. And, you know, I just moved here to Portland from New York City. And when I was in New York City, sometimes I would go out to my backyard and I would hold the binoculars up and there was a family of red-tailed hawks that lived on top of the church that I worked at, and they would perch up there and build their nest up there on top of the church, and I would look through my binoculars and I would watch them, and they were so, so beautiful. And sometimes I would even see a cardinal or a blue jay, and those were two of my favorite birds also, next to the red-tailed hawks, but I didn't get to see a whole lot of them because I don't know why there's not as many cardinals or blue jays or red-tailed hawks as there are sparrows. There are lots and lots and lots of sparrows. And in Jesus' teaching today in our gospel, he talks about sparrows. Now, I didn't have to go hunting for sparrows with my binoculars. They're just all around me, and I'm sure that they're all around you wherever you live. But Jesus uses the sparrows as a way to teach us how much God cares about us. And he's telling his disciples in our story today that they shouldn't be afraid. And the reason they shouldn't be afraid is because God knows every single sparrow that God has created in the world. And there's lots of sparrows in the world that God has created. And Jesus says, each one of you is absolutely known by God in the same way that God knows every single sparrow that God created in the world. And then Jesus says, not only does God know you as well as God knows every beautiful sparrow in creation, but that you are of even more value than the sparrow. And then Jesus goes on to say that God not only knows and feels and created you, but God also knows every single hair on your head. Now, that's kind of amazing. Can you imagine? I mean, think about all the hairs on your head and that God knows every single one of them. And think of all the sparrows in the world and that God knows and loves every single one of those beautiful little birds. Jesus says that you are even more valuable than the sparrow that God knows and loves. And so Jesus ends his story that he teaches his disciples that day by saying, "Do not be afraid. Wherever you go and whatever you do, God is always watching over you. You are more valuable than all the sparrows in the world, and God even knows every hair on your head." So maybe when you go out and do your hobbies this week, you'll remember that God is watching over you and loving you and taking care of you as one of God's most beloved creations. So will you pray with me? Thank you. Dear God, we thank you for all the beautiful creation you have made for us to enjoy. We thank you for the time that we get to also enjoy our hobbies, building things, being with our beloved companions, shopping even. We thank you, God, for watching over us, for teaching us not to be afraid because you are always by our side. And we thank you also, God, for knowing us so deeply and loving us so completely that we know that we are of value to you and to all that we come in contact with. Be with us this week. Teach us, walk with us, and watch over us. In Jesus' name, amen.
first reading is from Jeremiah chapter 20, verses 7 through 13. You deceived me, Lord, and I was deceived. You overpowered me and prevailed. I am ridiculed all day long. Everyone mocks me. Whenever I speak, I cry out, proclaiming violence and destruction. So the word of the Lord has brought me insult and reproach all day long. But if I say, I will not mention his word or speak any more his name, his word is in my heart like a fire shut up in my bones. I am weary of holding it in. Indeed, I cannot. I hear many whispering, terror on every side, denounce him, let's denounce him. All my friends are waiting for me to slip, saying, perhaps he will be deceived. Then we will prevail over him and take our revenge on him. But the Lord is with me like a mighty warrior, so my persecutors will stumble and not prevail. They will fail and be thoroughly disgraced. Their dishonor will never be forgotten. Lord Almighty, you who examine the righteous and probe the heart and mind, let me see your vengeance on them, for to you I have committed my cause. Sing to the Lord, give praise to the Lord. He rescues the life of the needy from the hands of the wicked. Here ends the first reading.
The second reading is from Romans chapter 6, verses 1 through 11. What then are we to say? Should we continue in sin in order that grace may abound? By no means. How can we who died in sin go on living in it? Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? Therefore, we have been buried with him by baptism into death, so that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we will certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We know that our old self was crucified with him so that the body of sin might be destroyed and we might no longer be enslaved to sin. For whoever has died is freed from sin. But if we have died with Christ, we believe that we also live with him. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. The death he died to sin, once for all. But the life he lives to God. So you also must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. Word of God, word of life.
Heaven shine forth.
A reading from the Holy Gospel of Matthew. Jesus said to the 12, "A disciple is not above the teacher, nor a slave above the master. It is enough for the disciple to be like the teacher, and the slave like the master. If they have called the master of the house Beelzebul, how much more will they malign those of his household? So have no fear of them, for nothing is covered up that will not be uncovered, and nothing is secret that will not become known. What I say to you in the dark, tell in the light, and what you hear whispered, proclaim from the housetops. Do not fear those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Rather, fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father. And even the hairs of your head are all counted. So do not be afraid. You are of more value than many sparrows. Everyone, therefore, who acknowledges me before others, I also will acknowledge before my Father in heaven. But whoever denies me before others, I also will deny before my Father in heaven. Do not think that I have come to bring peace to the earth. I have not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to set man against his father, and a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. And one's foes will be members of one's own household. Whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me, and whoever loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever does not take up the cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Those who find their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ. When Jesus initially called the disciples, it was a simple invitation. "Come, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men." It was a new job opportunity, if you will, and Jesus took them through a training period. They sat at his feet. They learned from him. They watched him perform healings and miracles. They went with him into the highways and to the byways, and they began to understand what this ministry that Jesus came to do was all about and what they were being asked to become a part of. And Jesus tells them, it's serious work. And as you go out, I need you to understand some things. I need you to undergo a radical reorientation of how you look at life, at how you look at this mission. When you go out, don't think that life is going to be any different for you than it has been for me. I think there's a temptation sometimes to believe that when Jesus calls us to follow him, to live in relationship with the divine, that somehow or other, it creates for us a zone of acceptance, a zone of comfort, a safety net that protects us from having to face the challenges that Jesus faced. So, our first reorientation is of our own self-perception. Jesus does not call us into a ministry of accolades and popularity. It is not a ministry of niceness. And we will not be exempt from public ridicule and opposition. Jesus calls us to understand in new ways what it means to be his disciples, the cost that we will have to undergo. And when we say yes to that call, we begin to reorient ourselves, to view life through through the lens of Christ's life. It is a call to radical obedience when the world turns against you, when the world rejects your message. Of course, none of us here today are as shocked as the disciples were back then to hear that families can be the cause of great conflict. Because in Jesus' day, the principal way people thought of themselves was as part of a close community, a tribe. To be separated from one's family, from that community, was to lose one's primary identity, one's security. It was the way the culture had of offering protection from one generation to the next. Now, certainly there are those of us here who never felt security from their family. They know that belonging to a family is no guarantee of protection and guidance. But I don't think that in this passage, Jesus is necessarily talking about the ordinary or extraordinary dysfunctions or cruelties of family life. Nor is Jesus anti-family. Does discipleship demand that we abruptly break from our families? Or is Jesus pointing to a different shift? Maybe he's talking about the divisions and the conflicts that occur between parents and children, brothers, sisters, husbands, wives, community, neighbors even, when the individual soul awakens and discovers its connection to something much deeper than before. The process of understanding one's divine origins. Perhaps Jesus' warnings to his disciples today are illustrations of what he's learning in his own divination process. It's like education in the field. And he warns that when we follow our own process of connecting with God, of connecting with that divine, our own process of divination, if you want to call it that, of which Jesus is indeed our working model, of deepening our love of God and accessing that source within us, that will probably mean a break with those who we have considered ourselves to be up to that point. When we begin to access our connection to the source of love and creativity, we begin to discover our heart's purpose. And this may come in conflict with what our families or our social groups desire from us and consider to be of value. However, Jesus is calling us toward a deeper, more personal mystery, which is at the heart of each human life, what we were born to manifest. And he uses jarring images of families rejecting one another, of coming persecutions, even death, to strip away our own narrow self-perceptions based on how others perceive us and how we should live. Jesus wants us to see ourselves with new eyes and to love what we see. Whatever it is that prevents us from answering his call must be called into question. That is the true risk of discipleship. The late clergyman, author, and peace activist, the Reverend William Sloan Coffin, wrote that when he was in seminary, he used to wonder what Jesus meant when he said, "Do not think that I have come to bring peace on earth. I have not come to bring peace, but a sword." And he concluded, after lots of contemplation about that, that the sword Jesus must have had in mind was the sword of truth, the only sword that that heals the wounds it inflicts. Jesus' work as peacemaker can make things worse before they get better. When you address the things that make for peace, you address the underlying injustices, the underlying unacknowledged prejudice and hate and evil and fear that's lurking in people's hearts and our own. When Jesus came, he was not a pacifier. He was an agitator. He was a fire starter. He knew that as the Prince of Peace, you can't produce and bring real peace without bringing justice. And justice is about power. And so far in human history, not many people have given up power willingly. And so confrontation comes. It was true in Jesus' day, as true as it is in our day. Sometimes things have to get worse before they can get better. And that, I think we're finding out that that's true for us today, and it's also probably going to be true for us in our own lives. And there might be things I'm unwilling to face, and the pressure has to heat up for me to get me humbled to the point and reduced to the point where I am willing to face some uncomfortable personal truths about myself. Things might need to get worse before we're willing to face reality, or as Reverend Coffin called, the sword of truth. Just as division offers physical, social, and emotional growth, it also offers spiritual growth. And Jesus here in this passage is calling us to grow up and recognize the division that makes growth possible. For our part, we must re-examine our relationships and our priorities and what we put our time and energy into. We must choose our relationship with God, the source of our being, as the one relationship that finally gives us the truest and most authentic identity. And this may come in conflict with what our families or our groups desire from us and consider to be of value. It is the division that loses nothing and gains everything. It is a division that does not diminish or reject others. Instead, it offers wholeness and connection. It is the division that transforms our lives, makes sacred all our other relationships, and heals the world. Those who find their life will lose it, Jesus tells us. And those who lose their life for my sake will find it. And remember, I want us to remember that at the close of this Gospel of Matthew, Jesus reminds us, "Lo, I am with you always, even to the close of the age." Amen.
Let us pray. Dear Lord God, thank you for the first days of summer. It is wonderful to see the sun in the early evening hours again. We are a church that needs your wisdom and guidance, and we need your help to boldly serve others in a hurting world. We have much to learn on how to do that effectively, how to listen, how to be patient, and how to help others, both near and far. In doing this, we learn much about ourselves and gain new perspectives. We need your help on answering Christ's call to love one another, using kindness and generosity as our biggest tools for this. Please lift us up and tenderly brush us off when we fail to be the servants we aim to be, whether individually or as the church. We try to live as Christ asks us to live, with the vision that is planted in our hearts. We ask for your help to live that vision. In turn, we need to know what to do, but with your help, we succeed more than we'll ever know. Be our light, be our joy, and remind us, your church family, that we are truly your eyes' delight and your children. Lord, listen to your children praying. Lord, send your spirit in this place. Lord, listen to your children praying. Send us love, send us power, send us grace. Holy One, this world is beautiful and needs our care. Help us to respect its fragility and help us to preserve it as a home for all living creatures. May we understand that we do tomorrow's work today by making and keeping the air pure and the water clean for all generations to enjoy. Let us hear what the oppressed have to say. Let us hear what those who suffer daily have to say. Let us support true justice for all and make this land a just land. Let us go and announce justice and love throughout the world, striving for justice as you walk beside us on this pilgrim journey. May enduring peace come about through changes made while on the search for justice. Guide and protect our police, protect our service workers, protect our doctors, nurses, EMTs, teachers, and the many, many folks who serve the public at this time. Protect all those who serve in our military. Protect and guide those people actively working hard to make changes that are needed in this world. Help the food banks to provide abundant food for those going without. Help us be wise when dealing with the difficult problems of our world, seeking answers that are led by the Spirit. May loving honesty and true acceptance prevail among all people, whether single, married, rich, poor, neighbor, stranger, young, old. May people find common community regardless of status or gender. Lord, listen to your children praying. Lord, send your spirit in this place. Lord, listen to your children praying. Send us love, send us power, send us grace.
Almighty God, we pray for those in need of healing from any form of physical illness or suffering, whether it be from COVID-19, from cancer, from surgery, from mental health issues, or from the everyday aches and pains that accompany us as we go through life. We ask that you give wisdom and strength to the doctors and nurses who care so selflessly for all those in pain. Help the suffering to trust that you are with them in their time of need, and give them a sense of peace in your presence. Give comfort to the families of all those who suffer. Give comfort to those who are grieving the loss of a loved one. Give comfort to all who suffer loneliness at this time. Help us find ways to reach out to each other so that though we may be physically apart, no one feels forgotten.
Lord, listen to your children praying.
send your spirit in this place. Lord, listen to your children praying. Send us love, send us power, send us grace.
For all this we pray to you, O Holy Lord. Amen.
And now let us join together in our Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. And we join together in professing our faith with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And now, as we prepare to send you forth from worship to connect and serve in our community, here are some opportunities to do that. First, to connect. Today at 12:30, if you are someone living alone through COVID-19, we invite you to join us with the group Soloists to talk about highs and lows of the journey. We have a Zoom gathering, and you can find the link to that on the weekly update. Also, an opportunity both to connect and serve. This Tuesday, June 23rd, from 4 to 5 p.m., is the first gathering of our anti-racism book study with the book White Fragility by Robin DiAngelo. To prepare for this gathering, we invite you to watch the video conversation with Robin DiAngelo called Deconstructing White Privilege, and the link for that is in the weekly update. And one third opportunity, one way to serve, if you have a garden, we're finding that there is increased need for food, and our food distribution through Community Table here at St. Luke is the last Saturday of the month. If you have extra produce, we would be very glad to share that with our hungry neighbors. So please contact judy@stlukechurch.com to schedule a time to drop that off. And now, receive the benediction.
Go live the love of Jesus, live justice, peace, and truth. For God's eye is on the sparrow, and God watches over you.
In the name of the Creator, the Redeemer, and the One who makes us holy. Amen. And now we join in our sending hymn. Thank you.